and he pulled out this rolled up magazine.
An open door.
And everything changed.
To a fantasy world.
All these women are wanting to do whatever I want them to do.
And the hard fall back to reality.
I have destroyed my life and the life of another person.
Well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this edition of the 700 Club. A great week and a great program ahead for you. Hey, Big Brother, where'd you get that term? It's from George Orwell's book, 1984, about the big, overwhelming government that controls everything. Well, one leading senator is thinking about suing over the government's electronic surveillance program.
Others in Congress are calling for prosecutions, not against the government, though. They're saying that the man who leaked the story is the real villain, even though others are calling him a hero. Charlene Israel has the story.
It's being called one of the largest national security leaks in recent American history. And the man responsible for bringing it to the public's attention is speaking out.
That awareness of wrongdoing sort of builds up, and you feel compelled to talk about it. And the
more Edward Snowden came forward and spoke to reporters Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras of The Guardian newspaper this weekend. He says he was on the job only 3 months when he discovered that the top secret government agencies were collecting phone records of Americans and gathering data from major U.S. internet companies. He says he revealed the program because it invades privacy.
Even if you're not doing anything wrong, you're being watched and recorded. I, sitting at my desk, certainly had the authorities to wiretap anyone, from you or your accountant to a federal judge to even the president if I had a personal email.
Government officials call Snowden's actions reckless and dangerous. President Obama said the government surveillance was necessary to fight terrorism.
But the fact of the matter is, in our modern history, there are a whole range of programs that have been classified because when it comes to, for example, fighting terror, our goal is to stop folks from doing us harm.
Some lawmakers are calling for Snowden to be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law, and the Justice Department has launched a criminal investigation.
It's dangerous to our national security, and it violates the oath of which that person took. I absolutely think they should be prosecuted.
Other lawmakers support Snowden's actions. Senator Rand Paul says he wants to block the NSA's broad surveillance programs.
But we're talking about trolling through billions of phone records. We're not talking about going after a terrorist. I'm all for that. But don't troll through a billion phone records every day. That is unconstitutional. It invades our privacy.
Senator Paul is considering filing a class action lawsuit at the U.S. Supreme Court. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Thanks, Charlene. You know, remember Ellsworth, the Pentagon Papers, I mean, the New York Times, et cetera, et cetera. The Supreme Court, the courts all cleared those people that this was important and that he was releasing all sorts of confidential stuff. The existence of this massive program, I don't think, is something that should be kept secret. I mean, let's face it. This is the invasion of the privacy of all of us, and I think we all ought to be in on the conversation. And if this man has to flee the country, I'm sure there must be some place, but there's some talk about him going to the Soviet Union. That would be a big mistake, or to Communist China, equally big mistake. But the government shouldn't go after him. He's a hero. Well, while the government surveillance program is designed to stop terrorist attacks, the FBI is apparently taking a very different approach to the issue. Lee Webb has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington, D.C.
That's right, Pat. The FBI has removed material that may be offensive to Muslims from its anti-terror training guidelines. A report from Judicial Watch indicates that materials linking the Muslim Brotherhood to terrorism or profiling terrorists as young male immigrants of Middle Eastern appearance are now gone. The Bureau calls such references unsuitable in the current political context. An independent group of subject matter experts reviewed the FBI's training material on counterterrorism. They recommended the removal of the offensive material on Islam from FBI offices around the country. Florida Senator Marco Rubio tells CBN News he has a plan to get rid of Obamacare. It would involve passing a constitutional amendment that would ban any law that taxes Americans who do not buy a good or service. The new health care law, Obamacare law, does just that. Rubio sat down with CBN's David Brody to explain the problem with that.
Under the ruling the Supreme Court had, if tomorrow the federal government decided every American must have a smartphone, and if you don't, we're going to tax you for not having a smartphone, they could do that under the logic of this ruling. So obviously healthcare is a much bigger issue. So we are basically filing a constitutional amendment which says that you can't do that, that the government cannot compel Americans to buy a service or a good by punishing them for not doing it.
And by the way, Rubio is calling his amendment the right to refuse amendment. He believes it will gain support when Americans start to realize just how bad Obamacare is. By the way, we'll have more of David's interview with Rubio Tuesday on the 700 Club. He goes in depth about his efforts to lead the way on immigration reform as well. A top Israeli official warns that Iran is planning on building more than just a nuclear bomb. It wants to build an arsenal of nuclear weapons. Israel's Strategic Affairs Minister Yuval Steinitz says Iran's goal is to produce dozens of nuclear bombs each year.
We are speaking about an historical game changer. It's going to change the world. It's going to create a dangerous new world, totally different than today. It's going to have terrible, dramatic effect, not just on the Middle East and Israel, but also in Europe and the United States and beyond.
Steinitz says international sanctions against Iran are significant, but it's not enough to make Iran abandon its goal of a nuclear arsenal. The number of homeschool children in this country has increased by 75% since 1999. The report found in Education News is more proof that a growing number of parents are rejecting public schools. Researchers also say the number of primary-aged homeschool kids is growing seven times faster than public school kids. Dr. Brian Ray of the National Home Education Research Institute says the increase is partly because the large number of children homeschooled in the 1990s are now homeschooling their own children. Currently, 4% of all school-aged children are educated at home. Well, a university in Belgium has fired a researcher for being too religious, and the school that fired him is historically Catholic. Dale Hurd has that story from Belgium.
The Catholic University of Leuven is the oldest and largest university in Belgium. It was founded in the 1400s under the approval of the Vatican. But as modern Europe has secularized, so has the university. And even here, faith has come under fire.
People can believe a lot of crazy stuff nowadays and not get fired from their jobs. But a senior research associate at the Catholic University of Leuven discovered that you better not believe that God can heal.
Fernando Pauls worked at the university's Research Institute for Work and Society for 11 years without a negative review when he was suddenly fired.
If you'd have asked me, do you get a new contract? I would say yes, of course. Do you have problems with your colleagues? No, everything's fine, you know. So there was no issues there. A week later, I'm out. And I'm like, what happened?
What happened was the Catholic University's great displeasure with Fernando's ministry website, powerthroughlove.be, that included testimonies of people healed through the power of God.
The university saw some of these movie clips of people giving a testimony of being healed, and they called that unscientific.
The university, which declined our interview request, said when a researcher working on matters of a scientific or medical nature allows religion to take the place of science, he compromises the scientific reputation of the university and breaks the bonds of trust with the university.
If I'm fired because of believing something unscientific like that, that Jesus Christ still heals, I'm fine. I'm okay with that, but it's wrong.
Ward Kennis of the Christian Democratic Party serves in the Flemish Parliament.
I was very much surprised that a Catholic university, which is also a university where I've studied myself, was behaving like this.
Rick Torfs, on faculty at the university, is also a national media figure who wrote about the case for the Flemish newspaper The Standard.
Freedom of religion means that people can believe whatever they like or whatever they feel attracted to.
Torfs was recently elected faculty dean at the university and told us that if elected, he would rehire Fernando.
So how can Belgium claim to have freedom of religion?
That's a good question. A right is not a right when it cannot be exercised.
Fernando, who has a heart for the persecuted church, especially in Pakistan, told us he feels privileged to have suffered for Christ. But he also wants those Christians who come after him to be protected from discrimination.
One day I'll stand in front of the Lord, and then he will say to me, "Well done." That's all that counts. That's all that matters. The rest is details.
Dale Hurd, CBN News, in Leuven, Belgium.
Yeah, Pat, he may not have tenure at that university, but I think he has tenure somewhere else.
He sure does, Lee. I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, this is the organization who believes in saints. They believe in the Madonna coming in and healing people. They believe in Louvre, the places where people go for pilgrimages. They have all kinds of traditions about saints and sacred bones and relics and the whole thing. And to fire a man who believes that Jesus Christ heals people, I mean, it's just totally contrary to the Catholic faith and to what they believe. A strange, strange thing. So he's not being scientific enough. Well, who's to say? Who's to say? Terry?
Well, coming up, it's an issue the church has ignored for too long, and people have died because of it. Hear how Christians are addressing mental illnesses. That's next.
Hi, I'm Chuck Woolery. You know, over the years, you've heard me say two and two, but now I'm here to talk about three for free. If you're struggling with pain and infection from old-style catheters, then you need Medical Direct Club's new virtually pain-free disposable catheters. Right now, you can get Medical Direct Club's three for free sample pack with one self-lubricating catheter, one polished eyelet catheter, and a travel-size catheter. You get your free pack, see which one's right for you.
You use an old-style catheter, they're rough, they're very painful. The new ones, virtually pain-free.
You know, Medicare and your insurance now pay for up to 200 of these virtually pain-free catheters per month at little or no cost to you. And if our catheters aren't virtually pain-free, then we'll pick them up for free. You'll never know unless you try them.
Call now to get your three for free sample pack.
Call toll-free 1-800-206-3360. That's 1-800-206-3360. Call now.
Tuesday. Bebo Norman's swan song. The award-winning singer joins us one last time before calling it a career. Plus, an addict fights for her life.
I was instantly addicted to the needle.
But the battle wasn't hers alone.
When you have a child that has this kind of problem, you have to go to warfare for them.
How they won the day.
The most important thing is don't ever, ever, ever give up.
Tuesday on the 700 Club.
Why do kids kill themselves? Teenagers, it's perhaps the most prevalent cause of death among teenagers, suicide. And I think many of these automobile accidents are actually death by cars. But few people want to talk about it. And now mental health is becoming a major topic for people in the church after suicides rocked two prominent evangelical families. Heather Sells recently spoke to Dr. Frank Page of the Southern Baptist Convention about how the tragedy affected his family.
Frank Page was alone at home when the call came that would change his world. His 32-year-old daughter, Melissa, had taken her life. Although she struggled for years, Page knew something had changed that week.
2 days before she died, I said, "Melissa, no one loves you like your daddy, and nobody knows you like your daddy. And I know something's wrong, bad wrong, baby. Please," when she was getting ready to go talk to her mental health professional, "you tell him that your daddy thinks that you need to be hospitalized."
As the top leader for Southern Baptist, Page sets the direction for the denomination's 16 million members. He's also served as a megachurch pastor. But Page calls parenting his oldest daughter one of his most daunting challenges. It's why he wrote Melissa, to encourage others on a similar journey and challenge the church to reach out. Page and his wife Dale recently invited CBN News to their Nashville home to talk about their daughter, their enduring grief, and their hope. The pages say Melissa accepted Christ as a child, but her life wasn't easy.
We worried about her constantly. Mm-hmm. Wanted to be able to help her.
But she struggled with addictive issues, behavioral issues, rebellion issues. She struggled in many, many ways, relationally. She was gifted beyond words and struggled beyond words.
In her 20s, Melissa reached a period of stability. She married and seemed headed on a smoother path. But then a bout with cancer led to a prescription pill addiction, and she spiraled downward once again. The pages say she never mentioned suicide, leaving them in shock the day she died.
People say, you know, she committed suicide in November. And what was it like the first Christmas? I don't remember. I don't.
We were still in that fog.
Now, the second Christmas, I well remember. Then the grief, it was even worse for me.
After more than 3 years, the pages describe their grief like waves, continually rolling in, but varying in frequency and intensity. Their great comfort, knowing Melissa is at peace in heaven. It's a biblical truth they say our culture has undermined.
People will say, well, if you commit suicide, you're going to hell.
It's a belief the pages want the church to challenge.
But I think you have to get to the point where, you know, if you belong to Christ and you are His child, then nothing can separate you.
It's a family thing, and family never changes.
Moving forward, the pages hope to build on the growing national awareness of mental health issues. It started with last year's Newtown shootings and continued in April with the suicide of Pastor Rick Warren's son.
I think the timing is fascinating, that indeed all these things have happened in a very short period of time. And I think God's going to use all those things, bad things, to bring forth a movement among God's people.
At its annual convention in Houston, the denomination will promote awareness of mental health issues. Page hopes to begin to ease some of the stigma surrounding these issues and to encourage churches to more proactively minister to those who are suffering.
There are legitimate, serious issues people struggle with. And the church needs to be the place where we say, we understand.
For those walking through grief or depression, Paige says the local church can help through support groups, counseling, or simply awareness of community resources. It's an enormous challenge, but with more than 36,000 people taking their lives each year, it could meet an enormous need. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Thanks, Heather. Ladies and gentlemen, our children are at risk. They're bulimic. There's anorexia. There's all kinds of demonic games they played. It used to be Dungeons and Dragons. They got some new ones now. But the pressure on them is just incredible. The pressure as they emerge from childhood into young adulthood and go through that time of puberty, it's really tough. Especially with girls, I mean, it's difficult, and you need all the wisdom of the Lord to know what to do about it.
And some people legitimately have chemical imbalances.
Oh, yes,
in their systems.
Absolutely.
And, you know, I can't imagine. I have had friends who've had children that have struggled emotionally and psychologically, and it's very heartbreaking and difficult. We need to come alongside those families as well as the people themselves.
They need to get the necessary testing, as you said, the blood testing, because these things are not, they're chemically induced, many of them, and it isn't enough to have some psychologist put you on the couch and say, well, tell me about your conflict with your parents when you're three or something. I mean, let's talk about these chemical analysis of people's blood to find out exactly what's going on, because those hormones do rage, and there's a tremendous amount of stuff going on in people's minds.
Sad story.
All right. Well, you had daughters. What you doing?
Well, we're still working on that.
ain't finished
you
yet.
Know, right, huh? I mean, I think today also with drugs, Pat, that's a huge thing. You know, people...
Yeah.
Kids get into things, their friends get into things, life happens. I mean, you know, as in that story. And some people just really struggle emotionally with being able to handle the things that life brings their way.
Girls, I mean, for example, their self-image is always so fragile. And there's so many pressures, and they've got to conform, and it's just terrible.
I think it's young men, too. I think they're just a tremendous social. social pressure to be and to fit into the mold of where everybody else is at, and it affects self-esteem. And you know, the world's going so fast. One of the things we heard from our experts in the DVD series Orphans Promise did was that parents need to be with their children, not just in the same room with them, not just hanging around the periphery, but really with them. And we move so fast. I'm not blaming parents in this at all, but I'm just saying it's very hard sometimes. You don't even know that your child's disconnected psychologically.
Well, they're using a different language. They're got all those little code words, and they're, are you, so forth, and they're typing these little things, and they spend all their time on those little devices, and they're not talking to each other either. They're not talking to their parents.
Actually, I know a lot of adults who do that.
Is there? Well, it just shows how freaky they are.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
All right.
Well, still ahead on our program today, a husband with an uncontrollable desire.
I had gone beyond pornography. I had started to have affairs that I would set up online, and I went and had sex with a woman. My downward spiral was fast and furious.
Watch what happens when his wife discovers his secret. That's later on today's 700 Club.
The simple truth is that today's investment world can be very confusing. In the short run, real assets like gold can go down and paper assets can go up, but not for long. So along with learning the truth about the dollar and inflation, my grandpa also is teaching me the four W's of wise gold investing. Why?
Gold is a store of value, a wealth preserver in a world that's flooded with debt.
What?
Gold coins are true money that can never be devalued.
When?
If you don't own any gold yet, Breda, you better buy it immediately.
Where?
Swiss America offers fair prices, great service, and higher education.
It's all explained in a simple truth newsletter, CD, and DVD. And best of all, it's free. Call or log on now for your free simple truth kit. Learn the basics about the 21st century gold rush for safety and growth. Next time, I'll explain the simple truth about a golden retirement.
Jack and I are having the time of our lives. The kids are on their own, and now we're back in control of our time and the way we spend our money.
That's why Consumer Cellular is the perfect cell phone company for us. We get great service, and compared to our old plan, we're saving a ton every month.
Consumer Cellular is the wireless provider for people who want affordable service without the contracts.
Listen, I don't think I'm cheap. I only
want to pay for what I need.
So what do you pay a month for Consumer Cellular?
My bill can be as low as $10, $15 a month.
Wow.
But we can change our plan anytime. So even those months we use it a lot, we're always getting the best price.
Try Consumer Cellular risk-free for 30 days with free activation, a $35 value, and free shipping. Consumer Cellular is the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members. Ask about your special discounts.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-730-5103. Go online to consumercellulartv.com or visit a Sears store today.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I want to encourage parents to understand one thing about young boys. Boys 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Their first exposure to pictures of naked women, especially anything having to do with pornography, can sear into their consciousness, and it's almost impossible to get rid of it. So just keep in mind what you're dealing with and do everything you can to have wholesome material for them to look at. But the internet is so pervasive, and you've got to make sure they can't get at the porn that's there. It's so easy to see. Well, from the moment he first laid eyes on it, this man we're going to talk about, Jonathan Daugherty, was hooked even before he knew what sex was. Jonathan wanted it. And over the years, he pursued his lusts, sank further into them, even as the rest of his world was crumbling around him.
It was a hot summer day, and 12-year-old Jonathan Daugherty was playing outside with a friend. The boy wanted to show him a secret.
Now, you have to understand, in my 12-year-old mind, I was thinking, we're going to see something dead. But when we got out into this field, there was this tree stump. He reached his arm down into this hollowed out portion, and I'm still thinking that must be he's grabbing the raccoon or whatever. And he pulled out this rolled up magazine. And then he opened it up and everything changed. It was porn. I'd never seen pornography. I didn't know why there were pictures of naked people and what they were doing, and I didn't do anything about it.
Pornography became Jonathan's secret too. At first he was confused by what he felt, but his awakened appetite wanted to be satisfied.
It was almost immediate that I started searching for more material, just sheer curiosity. I still didn't know what sex was. All I knew was there was something that reacted in me when I initially saw that porn.
His obsession with pornography grew. Jonathan eagerly searched for magazines and images to feed his craving.
All through junior high and high school, I was developing this secret addiction. The foundation of my ultimate addiction was learning to have a fantasy life that placed me in the center and had everything in my life revolve around me. All these women are wanting to do whatever I want them to do.
Despite fueling his fantasies through porn and promiscuity, Jonathan struggled privately with shame and self-worth.
Especially for a kid like me who grew up in the church, and there's an additional sense of shame. Every time I'd want to try to really go deeper in an authentic way with God, it's like my lust would take me on a detour. If you've failed for years and years and years in managing your sexuality, it's not a long trip to then think you are a despicable, horrible, perverted person and you have no value.
Jonathan met Elaine while attending college. They began dating and eventually married.
Well, what I saw in her was just this authentic person. I wanted more of that. I wanted more of her in my life because I thought this is a good thing. To have somebody with that much faith and purity and authenticity can be good. Marriage cured me for about 5 weeks, but it really wasn't until I was married and had this other person that sort of acted as a mirror to me that I saw just the depths to which I was really trapped in this.
Online porn no longer satisfied Jonathan. He wanted more. He discovered cybersex and spent his late nights in chat rooms with women who became online sexual partners.
Jonathan would withdraw a lot and spend a lot of time on the computer, and anytime that we were together, he would be saying things like, married the wrong person, hurtful things like that, and I would spend my time trying to think about, you know, was I so bad to live with? I started to catch him in lies, but not necessarily about big things, but about little things. I did find websites, I did find girls' phone numbers, but I was unprepared for the truth. I didn't know how serious things were, even though red flags were blowing.
I had gone beyond pornography. I had started to have affairs that I would set up online. One day I was in a chat room and a woman put two little words on the screen, "Want to meet?" And that was the first time in my marriage that I'd been challenged to cross a line out of the realm of fantasy into the realm of really real acting out. And I said yes, and I went and had sex with a woman. My downward spiral was fast and furious.
So was his guilt. He confessed to Elaine what he had done.
I told her everything. I told her about the prostitutes. I told her about the affairs. I told her about the internet, all of those kind of things.
I was just like a puddle on the floor. And that night, I did not think that the sun would even come up because I just thought I would just die because it hurt so bad.
Although Jonathan confessed everything to Elaine, he wasn't ready to give up his obsession.
Less than a week after that confession, I was in bed with another woman. And when I came home from that encounter, that's where I saw my wife with her bags packed.
I knew where he had gone. So I packed up my bags and I left. I never wanted to talk to him again. And I never wanted to see him again. I never wanted to be around him again. And I drove to my parents and I cried the whole way. I just felt very broken.
When I walked in and shut the door, the only way I can describe it was deafening silence. That was actually the catalyst that God used to shake me enough to kind of bring me to my senses, to where I started realizing I have destroyed my life and the life of another person. If I don't get help now, I will end up taking my life. Just started sobbing. I felt as if Jesus himself came right up next to me on the floor and just put his arm around me and said, "You know what? I know, I care about you. I knew this was coming, but this is right where I want you to be." And it was like the first moment in my life where I felt like, wow, that's what grace is. That's the God who loves me. That's the God who knows everything that's going to happen in my life before it happens and still says, I'm going to walk with you every step of the way.
Jonathan sought Elaine's forgiveness. He went into counseling and joined accountability groups. Elaine saw honesty and humility in Jonathan's change.
God began to work on my heart about forgiveness. Remember, you started your relationship with me when you were 5. I'm your first love. And how many times have you been unfaithful to me? Look how much I'd forgiven you, Elaine.
Elaine forgave Jonathan. After 7 months of soul searching and counseling, the two got back together.
God doesn't give up on a marriage. When we first got back together, I caught him being right. I caught him being pure. I caught him doing the right thing. And that went a long way for building trust.
I believe God unleashes his power for transformation in the life of somebody who's struggling with sexual addiction.
I've always appreciated the fact that you have truly shown me forgiveness because, you know, you have never, ever brought up my past against me since we've gotten back together. And I think that's a testament to your faith and to God's grace in our lives. And I just so appreciate that in you.
Jonathan and Elaine renewed their vows in front of family. They became parents to 3 children. And the Dohertys now have a ministry helping men overcome sexual addiction.
It's God's story of redemption, and then be able to see that He actually wants to take our brokenness, my brokenness, and then be able to help others with that. Just having my wife back in my life was way beyond any expectation I ever had.
What a story. But listen, it's played out all across America. We're not talking about a few thousand. We're talking about millions of men and women now, but mostly men, but both. But this pornography is pervasive, and it's a huge business, multi-billion-dollar business, where organized crime and those involved in it are preying on the lusts of people to make profit, and they're destroying people in their lives. But if you're one of those people, let me tell you, number one, Jesus still loves you. You have not sinned away your chance of redemption. There is still hope for you. And God will come down and set you free. It is an addiction. It is like a disease, and it is very powerful. But God is more powerful than your addiction and your disease. And if you will call upon Him, He will set you free. But you've got to mean it. You can't play with this. This is kind of like having a cobra in your backyard. You think he's going to be a playmate. He's going to kill you if he gets a chance. And this stuff will kill you if it gets a chance, because it speaks to the deepest emotion that we have in our lives. And it twists them, but nevertheless, it works on them. Now, would you like to be free? That's the question. Do you want to be forgiven? Do you want to be free? Do you want your marriage to be restored? Do you want to have a wonderful, wholesome life? It's not easy, but do you want to be free? And if your answer is yes, I want you to pray with me right now. And I don't want you to be afraid. I want you to bow your head wherever you are and let Jesus Christ take over. Pray these words, Lord Jesus Christ. That's right. Pray with me, Lord Jesus Christ. I'm yours, Lord. And at this time, I turn my life over to you, and I ask you to forgive me. You know what's going on in my mind. You know the temptation of my body, which has been lusty after that which is not pure. You know what's there, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that right now you might cleanse me, deliver me, set me free, and forgive my sin. I receive you, Lord, as my Savior, and I ask you to fill my life, fill my mind, fill my soul with yourself. Thank you, Lord, that you've heard my prayer, and thank you, Lord, that you've come in to my heart. Now, I want to pray for you wherever you are. In the name of Jesus, I want to pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for the power of God to come into people's lives. Set them free in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you prayed with me, I want to do something to help you. I have something that is a little book about temptation, and I think you'll find it very helpful about some of these sex things. We'll give this to you if you want it. I've also got a new day that tells you what to do next. I want you to go to your phone right now, and I want you to call in and just say, I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to the Lord. 1-800-759-0700. Wherever you are, just call right now and say, I prayed that prayer. I am free. And I want you to declare your freedom. You are free in the name of Jesus. And just say it over and over again. I am free. And Satan, I am free. But you give us a call and start, get this literature so that you can help find it places in the Bible that you can read and build yourself up in the Lord. Telephone number is toll-free, 1-800-759-0700. Quickly call. Lines are available. If anything, any reason they're busy, they'll be open very shortly. So call right now, toll-free. Tell us the good news. Terry?
Still ahead, a child with a hole in her heart needs life-saving surgery that her parents can't afford. Find out how she survived. That's later on today's show.
Drank until about 5 o'clock in the morning, passed out, hit a car head on. I can't really express in words the hollowness of that feeling. I was sentenced to serve 7 years in prison. My bunkmate, he just looked at me and shook his head, said, it's a real shame. You really have a heart that God could use if you would just let him.
God is a God of restoration, reconciliation, and redemption. There is always hope in Jesus.
Open your ears, people. Your phone company's living in the Stone Age.
Barbaric pricing models.
Outdated technology.
What we need is a company that connects us with generosity.
Is that so crazy, businessman?
Not to me. In fact, we should talk. Meet Vonage's new Chief Generosity Officer.
We shall no longer let time nor distance keep us from connecting.
That's crazy.
Crazy? Crazy generous.
See what we did?
Turned it around.
And welcome back to Washington for this CBN News Break. Protections for gay and lesbian students are buried in the proposed rewrite of the nation's massive education law. They include a ban on discriminating against students who are gay or perceived to be gay. Schools that do not provide protection to gays and lesbians could see a significant funding cut. Already, lawmakers in the Republican-led House are saying they're concerned the bill goes too far in telling local schools how to teach their students. CBN's Orphans Promise provided electricity to an orphanage in Cambodia. Teams installed the first ever solar power system to the orphanage that is home to 90 children on Lavisar Island. The system supplies electricity to power lights so children can study at night. The orphanage is also cooler now that fans can run in bedrooms and classrooms. CBN has been working on Lavisar Island since 2002. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club after this.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Tuesday, Bebo Norman's swan song. The award-winning singer joins us one last time before calling it a career. Plus, an addict fights for her life.
I was instantly addicted to the needle.
But the battle wasn't hers alone.
When you have a child that has this kind of problem, you have to go to warfare for them.
How they won the day.
The most important thing is don't ever, ever, ever give up.
Tuesday on the 700 Club. To see this week's top on-demand videos, go to CBN.com.
Well, it's hard to imagine a young child being excited about surgery. But one little girl in China had been waiting for years to have an operation that would save her life.
When Mrs. Fawn found an abandoned baby girl, she didn't think twice about taking her home to be her own. What she didn't know was that Tong Tong had a hole in her heart. It was a serious condition that only got worse as the child reached her toddler years.
I cried every day for her because she threw up all of the time. I decided I would die for her if I had to, so she could live.
Mrs. Fawn embraced her role as a single mother. She worked extra hours and took odd jobs to raise money for surgery for Tong Tong. Still, she never came close to having enough. And without proper medical attention, Tong Tong soon got to the point that it was a struggle for her even to breathe.
She was too weak to walk, and she coughed all the time. I felt so hopeless. Every day I was afraid that it might be her last. And I could not imagine losing her, because I had put everything I had into her. She was my life.
Mrs. Fawn took Tong Tong to the doctor one last time to see if anyone could save her sick child. A doctor told Mrs. Fawn that she should contact CBN. When she did, we promised to do everything we could to keep Tong Tong alive. That included helping to pay for heart surgery.
I told Tong Tong all about CBN. She was so excited that she quickly told everyone she met about how she was going to have a surgery.
The surgery was a huge success. And thanks to the nutritional supplements we gave Tong Tong, in just 1 week, she was doing things she'd never been able to do before.
Now Tong Tong can run. I remember how happy she was that first time. She screamed, "Look, Mama, I can run." And now she won't stop running. Thank you, CBN, for saving my daughter. You changed both of our lives forever.
You know, Pat and I were just talking about the caring nature of the Chinese people and how someone in extreme poverty yet will take in a child not their own with special needs, work so hard to try to make a difference and provide what that child needs. They just simply can't do it on the income that they make. So what an opportunity for you and I to step right into the middle of that need and bring the kind of hope that means life, that means a future, the kind of answer that they could never have dreamed possible. And isn't it amazing, 700 Club members, to know that in China, doctors are saying to people in need, you need to contact CBN. You make that possible when you join the 700 Club. It's not just happening in China. It's happening all around the world. And people right here at home in the United States are getting help because of your membership in the 700 Club as well. If you're not a 700 Club member, today's a great day to join. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month. If you're already a 700 Club member, we have many club levels you can join at. Consider going up to the next club level so we can reach out and touch even more lives like Tong Tong's. You do all of this by calling that toll-free number, 1-800-759-0700. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. When you do, we want to send you Gordon's latest teaching. It's called Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer. This is going to be a huge blessing to you. But most of all, you'll have the satisfaction of knowing you are literally changing lives with your phone call, with your gift, with your prayers and your commitment. So call now, 1-800-759-0700. And we just want to say thank you in advance for caring for others. Well, coming up next, an all-new edition of Bring It On. Gary says, my mom is sick, but she refuses to go to the doctor. She says if God wants to heal her, he will. What should I do? Stay tuned for your questions. That's next. Plus, a real-life Crash Davis tells us how he made it to the majors. You don't want to miss it, so don't go away.
give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there, providing food, thank you, and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place. Here you go. My life is hectic, so I joined CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are. Hi, good morning. Are you ready to get started?
If you've been thinking about financial options for your retirement, maybe how to provide some real security for you and your family, you really ought to consider a reverse mortgage with AAG. In uncertain times, it's a safe, effective financial tool. It's already being used by hundreds of thousands of other Americans. It allows you to eliminate monthly mortgage payments, pay some bills, or simply enjoy your retirement more. A government-insured reverse mortgage with AAG allows seniors to stay in their home and turn their equity into tax-free cash. To qualify, there are no credit score requirements, and remember, you continue to retain complete ownership of your home.
Call 1-800-789-8635 to receive a new special edition handbook featuring reverse mortgage borrowers, plus an educational brochure and DVD presented by Fred Thompson absolutely free.
Find out more. Call AAG today.
Call 1-800-789-8635 now.
Well, we've gotten lots of wonderful email questions from you, and so we want to take a few minutes to look at those and answer them today. Pat, this first one is from Gary, who says, my mother is sick, but she refuses to go to the doctor. She says that if God wants her to be healthy, he'll heal her. I couldn't disagree more. I feel like God gave us doctors and medicine as a way to aid in healing. I'm worried her health will decline if I can't change her mind. God doesn't think it's wrong to see a doctor, does he?
Gary, I believe firmly that God heals people. There's no question about it. And I have seen miracles, and we've heard of many miracles, and we pray for miracles, so I believe it. Nevertheless, I am grateful beyond measure for the skill that God has given the medical profession here in this country. We have wonderful doctors, compassionate, intelligent doctors. And when I think of the stuff they've done in my life that's kept me vigorous and healthy, I mean, I can't say too much good about them. So tell your mother, these doctors are a gift from God. So it is part of God's plan that we use doctors and medicine.
Okay, this is Angel, who says, I was baptized when I was 17 years old, but I didn't really understand the meaning behind it. Now that I've grown in my faith, I have a better understanding of the significance of water baptism. With my newfound understanding, I wanted to get baptized again, but my church refused to allow it. Is there something wrong with being baptized a second time?
Well, you know, in the Reformation, there was a group called the Anabaptists. They were the ones who wanted to be baptized again because they said, we were sprinkled before, but now that we're believers, we want to get baptized as believers. I wanted to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I had been baptized in a church, but I didn't do it as a believer. I was just a kid, you know, as
tradition.
12, kind of. You get baptized, so you join the church. So I got baptized again, so I guess that makes me one of
them. I did, too.
Did you really?
I did.
Well, that's...
Yeah, you know, there is, as the understanding of all of that comes,
right.
Your heart embraces it in a different way.
Well, I think if that church won't let you do it, go get someplace that will.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
There are plenty of them that will. This is Miriam, who says, I'm 17 and I truly accepted Jesus almost 3 months ago in boarding school, although I belong to a Christian family. My dad only allows me to participate in Christian programs through our church. The problem is that our church is focused toward the elderly. They don't have any youth programs.
I'm eager to learn more and meet other Christians my age. I want to do great things for God, but I feel stuck and alone. I don't understand my dad's hesitation. What should I do to grow closer to God?
Well, I read that letter. I visualize an old man speaking German with a dark frock coat and a beard, you know.
Well, that's mighty dramatic.
That's right. Thou shalt not, you know.
Yeah.
Really, I mean, of course you need to get out with young people and find some experience. I don't know what to say. You don't want to, you know, disobey your father, but your father's got to loosen up and let you have freedom. I don't understand.
And there's so many wonderful youth groups and
yes.
churches today. Our kids sometimes didn't go to the youth group of the church that we went to. They went where everybody was growing.
Well, it's where the anointing of the Lord mm-hmm. is. So, I don't know, maybe there's something you can find out that doesn't say church to it. You can tell your father, I'm going to the Skipaloo or something, but maybe he doesn't like that either. I don't know what kind of father you're dealing with, but he sounds awfully old world, like something out of the 19th century. All right.
This is Brian Pat, who says, how do you make wise financial choices during such an unstable economy? I've been putting off buying stock for months. When I finally made the decision to buy, the market crashed less than 12 hours later. I'm nearing retirement age. Should people my age just hold on to the money they have and forget about investments this late in life?
I read a survey the other day that indicated that, you know, people live longer. By the time you get to be 65, if you're a woman, you'll live to 86 average, and you could be into your 90s. So many people who outlive, if they take, we're not getting much on fixed income stuff, you know, 1 or 2% at best. So you've got to go into some kind of stock, or you're going to run out of money, and you're going to be broke when you've got 10 more years of life. I strongly, strongly recommend the master limited partnerships that pay such high dividends. They, you know, they're good companies. They process oil, they process gas, they process all these things like a railroad. And they pay 8-9%, 7%, some as much as 10%. And you also have the opportunity to have appreciation of the stock. So look for exchange-traded funds, ETFs, and master limited partnerships, and see some that are solid and pay some money. All right, one more last time.
Okay, this is Jean, who says, my family is going through a very tough financial time. No matter what I try to do to turn this situation around, the hits keep coming. How can I trust that God is who He says He is when I'm dealing with unemployment, bankruptcy, and foreclosure?
This sounds pat, but I'm giving it to you. The surest way out of the desert is through overcoming praise.
Yeah.
You start praising God, and you start thanking God, and you start expecting from God, and a man shall eat good by the fruit of his lips. You are speaking to the world around you that blessing is going to come, and you devote your whole mind. Forget the bankruptcy, forget the poverty, forget the other stuff, and begin to focus on that and start thanking God for what he's going to do, and then expect the miracle. That's the way out. No other way is going to get you there. Terry?
Well, we thank you for your email questions, sound advice. Thank you so much, Pat. We invite you to email us anytime you'd like with questions that you have. Well, for aspiring major leaguers, the road to the show can be a difficult one, filled with late nights and long bus rides from Tucson to Tacoma. Only a lucky few make it to the bigs, like Philadelphia Phillies backstop Erik Kratz. Recently, he sat down with sports reporter Sean Brown, and Erik told him why he never gave up.
Turn his runner loose on the count.
Philadelphia Phillies catcher Erik Kratz is living his childhood dream.
I think a lot of kids, at least a lot of kids where I grew up, they wanted to play Major League Baseball. They wanted to play for the Phillies because I grew up just north of here. And I always wanted to be a Major League Baseball player, but along the way, there was times when it wasn't looking too hot that I was going to make it.
Erik was selected in the 2002 MLB draft by Toronto. He thought he would be like most major league players and spend roughly 4 years in the minors before being called up to the big leagues.
I remember talking to my wife about it, and I said, you know, if it doesn't happen in 5 years, you know, well, that'll be it. Well, 5 years went by like that, and nothing happened.
5 years came and went, and no call up to the bigs. And with a 4-month-old son at home and the finances tight, it was time for Erik and his wife to make a decision.
That fifth year, you said about, you know, fifth year would have been 2007. We had that discussion because she has a good memory. She's a good planner and a good memory. She's like, you said 5 years, right? And I said, yeah. And she goes, well, I'm not ready yet.
After praying and asking God for guidance, they decided to stick with it.
We just both felt peace that we should stay in baseball. And he continued to open doors. Sometimes they were small, tiny little doors that we had to squeeze through, but he was opening them. And there was no doubt that we had to continue to do what we were doing.
After spending 7 seasons in the Blue Jays minor league system, Erik eventually got picked up by the Pittsburgh Pirates organization in 2009. But the following season, his dream became a reality when he was called up to the big leagues.
Up until that point, I'd always been passed up. I wasn't the guy that they, you know, if there's two guys, well, not him. You know, let's take someone else. But getting that call was awesome.
In 2011, Erik signed a deal with the Phillies. And he's using the opportunity to share about the love of Christ and God's faithfulness.
I want my presence here in the big leagues to be a beacon of bright light for the Lord, for people to come to the Lord, for people to get to know the Lord. The Lord walks beside me every day. When I play on the field, I want people to see that. I'm still competitive, I'm still working hard, but I'm going to give it everything I have for the Lord.
As should we all. Great job, Erik.
Yeah. Tremendous testimony and a wonderful, man, I'm glad I'm not in that pressure cooker. Boy, you got a bunch of people looking at you and they're counting.
Constantly.
You saw Moneyball. You see your stats, your stats, your stats. You don't make it, you're out. All right, that's all the time we've got for this edition of the 700 Club. Thank you so much for being with us. On tomorrow's program, we're going to head to the birthplace of the Boston Bombers to see what Muslim radicals have planned for that country. And today, we leave you today with these words from 1 Corinthians. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. That Greek word is agape, and it's there's a phileo, which means brotherly love. There's eros, which means sexual love. But agape is the love of God Almighty. And that's the love that He has for each one of us. Well, for Terry and Lee and all of us, this is Pat Robertson. Thanks so much for being with us, and we will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Tuesday. Bebo Norman's swan song. The award-winning singer joins us one last time before calling it a career. Plus, an addict fights for her life.
I was instantly addicted to the needle.
But the battle wasn't hers alone.
When you have a child that has this kind of problem, you have to go to warfare for them.
How they won the day.
The most important thing is don't ever, ever, ever give up.
Tuesday on the 700 Club.
He healed the sick, walked on water, and rebuked the storm. Jesus performed miracles that changed the world, and He shared the secret to that power with you and me.
Gordon Robertson, in his latest DVD, Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, takes you on a journey from King David's palace to the Sea of Galilee, revealing the mystery and the meaning of the greatest prayer of all time. You'll discover a deeper relationship with God, what it means to overcome evil, how to pray in the power of the kingdom, and the life-changing purpose God has for you. As a special bonus, you'll see a tour of some of Israel's most important sites and learn the amazing discoveries that are being uncovered today.
Learn how to pray the way Jesus prayed and release the power of God's kingdom in your life.
Get Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, available now.